Hi folks, thanks for joining us today for another one of our webinars. This one's on Hyperledger Aries. This is the third in the series of our webinars on self-sovereign identity and decentralized identity. If you missed any of the previous ones, you can catch them again on our Candatus YouTube channel. My name's Richard Astley. I'm a solutions architect for Candatus. And I'm joined here today by Mikko, one of our senior developers. In our previous webinar, we looked at some of the standards and protocols being used within self-sovereign identity and decentralized identity. We also had a look at the agents and the wallets which are used to sort of store, hold and manage your identity. We also looked at the interoperability challenges of using different self-sovereign identity stacks. We also gave a demo of Candatus's decentralized identity staff passport system to show you a real working decentralized identity system in use. In today's webinar, Mikko's going to talk us through more about Hyperledger Aries. He's going to show us a demonstration today using Evernym's Verity 2 Cloud Agent and ConnectMe Wallet. What he's going to do is he'll show us the steps it takes to set up an agent on the cloud. He'll register a new issuer and he'll also create schemas and credential definitions to start issuing verifiable credentials out to a ConnectMe wallet. You'll then also show the verification side of this, where we can start trusting these credentials and start providing some sort of access based on this. So without further ado, I'd like to pass you over to Mikko now, and he'll talk to us more about Hyperledger Aries.
Thanks, Richard. As we just mentioned, today I'm gonna quickly first tell about Hyperledger Aries. But the main part of the webinar today is going to be about showing the demos and going through how that will work in practice. So Hyperledger Aries is part of the Hyperledger community, which is building and supporting all kind of blockchain based solutions and technologies. And the Aries project within that is for building agents and applications on top of that stack. So the goal of the Aries is to enable the peer-to-peer communication between the agents and other agent like things that work on that ecosystem. And it's built based on the indie technology, but the goal is to have Aries as a technology like agnostic to the blockchain implementation that it uses and to provide interoperability. So what's actually specified in Aries? First of all, there's a concept for what the agents actually are. So there's a specification what they are and what's their role in that. And also the deed communication. So that's specifying the secure and private interoperable communication between the agents. And then there are protocols. So these are the specific communication flows that are, for example, issuing and verifying the credentials and creating connections and that kind of things. And the key management, so distributed key management is also specified as part of Aries, not as a specific implementation, but as a concept for the implementers to follow. So Hyperledger Aries resources are publicly available. So the bulk part of the specifications are in the RFC's repository, so it's a public GitHub, anyone can access that. So it contains all the specifications that I just mentioned and a bunch of upcoming work for the specifications as well. Aries also contains agent framework, so these are the kind of implementations of specific agent stacks to languages like Python or JavaScript to .NET. So these agent frameworks can be used to implement the applications. There are also some development tools to, for example, testing the agent implementations and testing the connections and all kind of things that help the development process. And there are also some upcoming libraries. If you want to have a lower level access to the capabilities that are built for different parts of Aries. So that's the quick overview of what the Hyperledger Aries is about. And then quickly about Verity. So as Richard mentioned, today's demonstrations will be using the Evernim's cloud agency called Verity. And it's a scalable production ready agency, which means that it includes services where you can access agents that are hosted by Evernim on the cloud. And you access these agents using either REST API or native SDKs for various languages. And the agents on that agency are compliant with Hyperledger Aries. So they implement the Aries interop profile, which means that whatever wallets you use, if they are Aries compatible, they are able to communicate with these agents. And the purpose of using this kind of service instead of building your own agent is that it's really much simpler than trying to implement that DITCOM, all the Aries protocols yourself, and you can rely on trusted and scalable implementations. And the protocols that are implemented are, for example, creating connections between agents and wallets and issuing credentials and verifying and so on. So that's what I'm going to be using for the demos. A quick overview of what I'm going to build today. So it's based on this Evernim agency, Verity, and it's also using the data repository. In this case, I'm using Sovereign's StagingNet ledger. So that's a ledger used for development and testing purposes. So based on these two, I will have some applications there to represent the issuer and the verifier. And I will be using a mobile wallet, ConnectMe, to represent the credential holder. So for each of the issuer and verifier, I will have an agent provisioned in that Verity agency. And I will communicate through the REST API with that agent. And the notifications, if there's something that the agent wants to notify my application about, is implemented using a webhook. And the communication between the agent and the holder is the Aries specified DITCOM messages. There are also some public parts that will be used as part of this demo. So issuer will need to have public information in the ledger, as well as the schema and the credential definition that needs to be publicly available to be able to verify the credentials. So that's kind of the big picture for today. But let's start by jumping into our first demo. So in the first one, I will create an agent. So this is going to be the same process for issuer or verifier. So I'm just going to do this once. So what I will need to do is to register the webhook. So that's the application that I have that can receive notifications. I'll also set the name and logo for that agent, and those will be displayed by the wallet application when they create a connection to the agent. Well, let's jump onto the demos. So first, quickly, an overview of the configuration that I have and the setup. So here I have some configuration that's needed for me to be able to access the Verity service. So I've got a URL. So this is where the Verity application is running. And then the domain DID and API key, which is used to authenticate my calls to that agency, and the domain DID to identify my agent on there. So the messages will be routed to the correct agent. And the agent configuration is here to specify where the logo is, the name of the agent, and the location of the webhook. And the webhook application that I'm going to use is a simple .NET Core application that just logs all the requests. So anytime there's a request, it will be recorded as a JSON file based on the time the notification was received. The file will be stored so I can later go back to and access the details in the notification. And in the end, I will just return a message to the agency that made the webhook call to notify that the call was accepted. Okay, so let's go to the first part. So the agent setup. So as I said, the first thing is to set the webhook URL. So before this, I only have the API key that I'm using and the domain DID that identifies my agent that's provisioned in Verity Cloud. So I will need to use this type of message. So I will call an update com method message with the value of the webhook URL that I have. So once this call is done, I will be able to receive notifications. So let's send this request now. I will get back a message, everything is okay. And also, I will see that there's a new call to the webhook with this content. So that's really simple content at this time, but it tells us that the webhook is correctly set up because I can now receive the notifications. So let's go to the next step. So that is to update the agent configuration. So in this, I want to set the agent name and the logo URL. So I will just set the correct environment to have the agent name is going to be Slay Register and the logo URL is a publicly available PNG image. So calling this one, I get the return message that the call has been accepted. And in the background, I should just in a minute receive a notification. Sorry, I probably need to run this once more because I changed the environments. So setting up for the correct agent this time, I'll send a message here and I get back a notification that I have set up these configurations and I can now start using the agent. So that's the agent setup complete with these two calls. So let's take a look at what's the next part of the demo. So the second demo is going to be registering an issuer. So an issuer agent needs to have some public information in the ledger. First, I will need to register the issuer details in the agent. So I will send a REST API call to the agent and the agent will then create the necessary details, store them in the agent's wallet and send back the DID and the necessary details that I will need to then write through the sovereign registration into the ledger. So let's see how that works in practice. So issuer setup, first of those calls, as I mentioned, is to the Verity agency again. So this time I'm just using a specific message, issuer setup, to create a new issuer details. I'll send that over get a message that the call's accepted, everything's okay, and see what kind of notification I get back. So this time the notification to the webhook includes the details about the issue. So the DID and the where key, the public key that I need to write to the ledger are now here. So I will copy this over because this will be used later on and put them into my configuration. So I have already put a place for the issue DID here. And also take the public key, copy it over. And save that. So then I can go on to the next step, which is to the registration of the ISIR in the sovereign ledger. So in case of the testing staging net, I can use this self-service to call with the details I have to register those into the ledger. So once that's complete, I should have a message with the status code 200. So everything went well. So now I'm registered as an endorser on the ledger. So that's it for the ISIR registration. Let's see what's the next step. So before being able to issue credentials, I will need to register the schema and the credential definition on the ledger. So now that I have the ISIR registered, I can use the agent to write the schema using the REST API call, and the agent will then use the necessary protocols to write the schema on the ledger. And same with the credential definition. I'll send over the call to write the credential definition, and the agent will write them to the ledger. Okay. So the credential setup. The first call is to register the schema, and in this one, I will need to use the write schema message. I will need to pick up a name for my credential schema, a version number, and then list of the attributes that schema includes. So I have these five attributes here that I want to register. So I can just call the agency like this, I get the message accepted, and I also get the webhook notification. So let's take a look at this. So now that I've written the schema, I get back the schema ID. So this is what I can use when I'm referring to that schema anywhere, as it is publicly available. So I'll copy this over, because I will need this value later. Again, I will put that into my configuration files as a schema ID and save that. And the next step was to write the credential definition. So the schema doesn't necessarily need to be registered every time you start issuing credentials, but you can also reuse an existing schema. But the credential definition is specific to the issuer. So every time an issuer wants to use a schema to issue credentials, they will need to register their own credential definition. So this is done with the write greddef message. I will need to, again, pick a name for the credential definition, tag it with a version number, and then refer to the schema that I just created. So I have this schema value here. And then I can just send the message over to the Verity agent. So the message was accepted. It'll take a while for the credential definition to be written. And there I can see that I get a webhook notification. And again, I get the necessary details for that credential definition, which is the credential definition ID that I can then take and use later on when I start issuing credentials. So I'll copy that over, put it to my configuration. And save. So that's the issuer now ready for issuing credentials. Let's move on to the next step. So issuer is now ready, but we'll need to have a connection to an agent in the mobile wallet before I can issue a credential. So this is again the same process, whether it's the issuer or the verifier. I will first need to create a relationship. So this is something that happens in the agent, and I will get back the relationship details. So at this point, there's a relationship within the agent, but it only has connection to its own part. So it doesn't have any external wallets, external agents connected to that relationship. So next, I will need to call the agent again to create an invite. And I will get back the invite details. I can encode those details into an URL or QR code. And then the wallet application that wants to connect can read the invite. When they accept it, they will send a message based on the details in that invite to the agent, and that will establish the two-way connection between the two agents. Okay, let's see how that happens. So we'll go to the connection script. So this time I will need to specify a thread ID that identifies and links the two calls together. So the first one to create the relationship and the second one to create the invitation. So I will just enter a random GUID and then make this call to create the relationship. So that's all fine. Let's look at the webhook notification. I get back the DIT and VAR key. So these are now the identifiers for that relationship that I have created in the agent. And this DIT I can use as when I refer to that relationship in the further calls to issue or verify details with that agent. So I will copy that DIT as a relationship DIT here, store that, and continue on to the next step. So I have created the relationship. Next, I will need to create an invite. So let's send that message over. Oh, sorry, I was on the wrong one. Connection, create invitation, this one. Okay. I get accepted message here. So let's see the notification. So here, I have received an invite URL. So this is what I can use to connect the agent in the wallet with the agent on the Verity agency. So I could have the mobile wallet click a link with this URL, or I can encode that into an URL, into a QR code. So I will use a tool to do that. I will also open up my mobile application on the right-hand side here. Paste the URL here, and that will generate a QR code. So now scan the QR code with my mobile phone, and I'll get a message to connect. When I accept the connection, we should have a notification here. Yep. And the connection has been successfully made with the wallet. So there are actually a couple of different webhook notifications here. The first one is that the wallet has received the request. This is the DIT document that is used to establish the two-way communication. So you can see here is, for example, the service endpoint that is used by the mobile wallet. So I can use this endpoint to send messages using all the necessary routing keys and all that to point them to the correct agent. The next messages are just to establish that two-way connection that is secured. So I now have a connection between the wallet and my agent on Verity. And I can use this relationship DIT to refer to that. So let's see what's next. So now we can go on and start issuing credentials. So first of all, I will need to send an offer. So the offer will include the details for the credential that can be then previewed by the holder. So I will send an offer through the agent to the wallet. When the wallet accepts the offer, I then know that I can go on and issue the credential. So I send a message to the agent, which will then create the final credential and send it over to the holder's wallet. Let's see that in code. So issuing credential here. Again, I will need to have a thread ID that links together the two separate calls, first to send an offer and then to finally issue the credential. So the issue, sending the offer, as I said, it needs to include the details that I want to be included in the credential. It also needs to refer to that credential definition ID that we created earlier and the relationship date to point to the correct relationship where I want to send this offer to. So here I can send this request. I'll open up my wallet on the right-hand side. That's gone through. I should have a notification on the wallet. So I have a new credential offer. I can see here all the details and I can choose to accept the credential into my wallet. Once I do that, I will get a webhook notification here. So this one is the one from my wallet, a notification that it has accepted the request. But as you can see, it's still loading, so the instance is not finalized yet. That's because I haven't made the second call, which is to finally issue the credential. So I will just refer to the same thread ID that I used in the previous call. Send that message. I get a notification here, and I should soon get the credential in my wallet. So now I can go here, see my credentials. I have it here on my wallet and I can start using it. Okay. So that's the credential issued. So the next step would be to use the verifier to verify the credential. So this time we have a different agent and we send a proof request through that agent by the verifier to the holder's wallet. And if they accept to share the details, they can share the proof with the verifier by sending the presentation to the agent, and that the agent will send a webhook notification message to the verifier that includes the details from the presentation. Let's take a look at that. So first of all, I will make sure that the other agent, which is going to be the verifier, has the correct configuration. It has a different name and a different logo. Okay. And that's all good. And then I can go to verify credential. So this is a single request to the REST API. Again, I will bring up my wallet application. And in the request, I will again specify the relationship to point to the correct agent that I want to communicate with. The name that will be displayed as the request, so it identifies what the request is for. And then the proof of attributes that I want to get information about. So in this case, I will want to use that credential to get a registration date, nose color, and if the nose has a mask on. So I will get values for these attributes. And it also specifies the restrictions. So these are for defining what kind of credentials are acceptable in my use case. So what kind of schema ID, for example, can be used. So if I'm specifying a schema ID here, that means that the credential used by the wallet to fulfill the values to these attributes needs to come from credential that's issued with this schema. Alternatively, we could, for example, specify an issuer deed to restrict the credentials so that they can only come from a specific issuer. So there are several different options how to restrict. Also, if you don't want to restrict anything, you can just take out the restrictions. You can even switch this value to true, which means that the wallet owner can just populate the fields manually and put any values they want in them. But in this case, we want to have verified values based on the schema. So I will send this message. So I will send that over here. And again, I will get a notification. Let's see. So I will have a proof request here that the Gemini wants to do an entry check and they want to know details from a credential. So here I can go and select which credential to use. At the moment, I only have one option, so I will use the details from my slate registration to populate these values. And I will choose to share these attributes. And then that's that done. So I can go check the webhook notifications. So here, the webhook notification will include all the details I need to start using the values I received. So I will have the revealed attributes. If I would allow self as testing, then I would have them listed here. So the attribute list will include the values that the holder had in their credential. There's some metadata also to about the credentials that were used. In this case, that's just one credential used to fulfill these values. Also, the verification result says that the proof has been validated, which means that I can trust that these credentials are valid. So now I can start using this in my applications any way I want. So that's the part of the verifier complete. Okay. I have just one more demo to show. So that's slightly different. So it's a question answer protocol. So it's just demonstrating that there are various different protocols in Aries and also mechanisms to specify your own protocols. So this question answer is quite handy in some use cases. So the issuer or verifier or any agent really can ask a question by sending that request through Verity to the agent, which will then send it over to the specified holder. And the holder will select an answer that will be forwarded back to my original application. So let's see how that works. First question here, I'm specifying that type of the message to be the committed answer. So that's the messaging question answer protocol. The relationship again, and then some text and details about the question I want to ask. And I also have a list of valid responses. So let's see how this looks. I will send over the request here. And it'll get a notification. So here I can see the text I provided in the request. And I can select one of the options to answer. So let's pick one, submit the answer, and that's that done. Again, I should see a new webhook message here. And I can see the answer that they answered. I can use the thread ID to identify if I'm sending out multiple questions. I can identify with the thread ID what was the original connection that I was sending this message to. So that's quite as simple as that. I'll show a slightly different UI that works with the two valid responses. So if I send that message, let's change the sender of the message to the issuer. I'll send the request here. I get a message to my wallet application. So this time I have just two options. The first one is displayed as with a correct answer kind of UI, and the second one is kind of cancel type of answer. So I can select from this answer, and similarly to the previous one, I will get a notification that my message is sent, and I will get back my answer. So that's really that. That's all for the demos for today. So I will now hand over back to Richard, and please ask if you have any questions.
Thanks, Mikko. That was a really good demonstration of Verity 2 product. You made it really clear how to set up an agent and how to start creating and issuing your own credentials and verifying. So thanks for taking us through that today. We do have a couple of questions. The first question was, how much does Verity cost? You know, is it free to use?
Yep. Good question. So Verity 2 is, as you can see, I can use it before actually using it in production systems for testing purposes, completely free. So there are actually several different options how I can use it. One is to ask for access to Verity's cloud service. So I get the domain date and the API key that I need to connect to my agent on that service. Or I can use their local version of that Verity, which I was doing today. It's a Docker image that I can use for testing purposes. And when you want to use it in production, in that case, you will need to go into an agreement with Evenim. So we can attach links to their production sites where you can see different options for the in production and paid services.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you, Mikko. We had another question coming in asking, is there alternatives to Verity?
Yeah, so this the idea of the Hyperledger Aries is really that we have an interoperable way of communicating between the agents. So that means that I can switch, I can keep using my Connect Me wallet, but I can switch to any agent that supports the same protocols. So at the moment, there are, for example, in the Aries community, they have different agent frameworks that implement those protocols, like the AkaPy is the Python cloud agent, which has similar functionality. There are also different providers, paid providers for this kind of services. For example, Trinsic has a similar kind of product to Verity.
Great, Mikko. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we've had another question come in here. Can the question and answer program be used to facilitate knowledge-based questions for authentication purposes? Similar to the three number options as in the Microsoft Authenticator.
Sorry, think the your volumes were low, but the question from the chat I can see is about the question answer protocol and using it to facilitate the knowledge based questions for authentication. So I think it's really, yes, it can be used for that. So the idea with the question answer protocol is that it's really simple and it doesn't really specify what it's used for. One really common use case is to verify that, for example, if you're in a phone with your bank, for example, you can get a message like that to kind of build up the trust that you're actually communicating with the correct with the other party, that they are actually what they claim to be. So if the bank calls a person, they can also send that question answer protocol to ask if you're actually now in a phone with a bank. So if you're in the phone, you get the message, are you on the phone? Yes, I am. If you're not, if you're just walking on the street and get a message on your phone saying that, are you in a phone? You can say no, and the bank can react to that and end that connection that might be fraudulent. So that's one of the use cases with authentication and the knowledge-based questions. I'm not sure if I'm familiar with the Microsoft three number options. I can definitely look into that and answer that specifically later. But the protocol itself, I would say that it supports uses like that.
Yeah, hopefully my mic's a bit better now, folks.
That sounds better now.
Yeah, thanks, Mikko. Yeah, so it sounds like it probably would support that, or it would need to obviously be built into any authentication journey, but it could be a step which was to invoke the question answer protocol and then dictate the next step based off the answer. So I think that's one of the advantages of creating a secure connection between the agents, is it allows for any type of messaging you want using this question and answer protocol. And once it's been established, it's really down to the verifier what they choose to do with the answers. So thanks, Mikko. I think that's all the questions we've had in for today. So let's just move on. I'll just give a quick summary today. Today you've obviously heard Mikko talk a little bit about Hyperledger Aries. The main part of today's webinar was really the demonstration using the Verity to Cloud Agent. And Mikko used the REST API of the Cloud Agent to show us how to set up an agent. He also showed us the steps to register an issuer and what actually gets written onto the ledger to support that issuer. He also showed a new schema being created and a credential definition, and again showed us this being written to the ledger. Once he'd created this, he showed us the REST API again, creating connections with a user's wallet really, and then issuing credentials over that connection. And finally, a verification step to show how SSI can really save Christmas this year and allow Santa all to access our chimneys during the COVID restrictions that we've got this year. So I think that was a really great example, Mikko. So thanks for taking the time today. So we've got more webinars planned for January coming up. So we've got another one in our SSI series on the 20th of January, and that's going to be on PSYOP and the Microsoft Authenticator app. So this is really Microsoft's DID project and how they've approached decentralized identity. If you've also been following our B2C webinars, we've got the next one of those coming up on the 13th of January, where you can hear all about API integrations and user management using Azure AD B2C. So please join us again for that. As always, all of our webinars are published on the Candatis YouTube channel. So if you've missed any of them or you can't attend in person, you can always catch up again there. And you can also subscribe to our channel and we can send notifications out to you in case you miss any of those. But I'd just really like to thank you all again today for joining our webinar. And I hope you all have a really good festive holiday. If you're interested in using any of our decentralized identity solutions, get in touch with us on info@candatis.com and we'll get back to you with one of our specialists. But again, thanks very much for your time today.